I wanted to speak about a moment in African history that isn't really popular, at least in the Western world. We often hear about Zulu glory in the Battle of Isandlwana, and also their ultimate downfall, but we rarely hear about one of the most disputed moments between Zulu and Boer interaction. What up, African world? It's Home Team here, and welcome back to another video of African history, culture, and worldview. By supporting this channel on Patreon, you're helping in the creation of these videos and supporting this content. If you'd like access to full courses and sources, or you simply want to show your support, you may do so by clicking the Patreon link in the description box below. This moment in Zulu history is known as the Piet Retief Delegation Massacre. All too often, we hear about the power of the pen to shift perspectives, especially as it concerns African history. I'm not too familiar with the history books in South Africa during apartheid, but from what I hear, they have a tendency to focus on the white settlers and the wars fought between them and the African nations. Apparently, not a lot of attention is brought to African history before their arrival. One of the more popular stories is the so-called massacre of Piet Retief and his 100-member delegation of settlers who had negotiated a land treaty with the Zulu king at the time, Dingane. This history is interesting because it's a clear example of perspectives, none of which can be wholly discounted as wrong or untrue. The white settlers, along with their servants of African heritage, were invited to a celebration of their agreement with the Zulu. Dingane ordered the delegation to be taken captive and killed, with their bodies being left to wild animals in typical Zulu fashion. This history is mostly presented in a way that paints the Zulu as brutal and untrustworthy, and the Boer delegation as noble and innocent. In other words, white supremacist propaganda. However, the reason why this history can be presented from multiple perspectives is because we really don't know the full details to make a conclusive judgment. But for this video, of course, I'll be giving the African perspective, which is so often neglected. So to be clear, this is not intended to discredit any other narrative. It's simply intended to present a neglected one. I think we can all agree that the white supremacists in South Africa during that time wanted to acquire land, and they didn't shy away from violence to acquire that. Most of them considered the land largely empty and imagined that they were gracious in sharing their technology with the so-called black savages. Even though the Zulu were largely painted as such, they weren't stupid and knew exactly what the Boers were trying to do. One of the Voortrekker groups, led by Piet Retief, as mentioned before, tried to come into an agreement with Dingane of the Zulu. Before the meeting, Piet Retief sent letters to Dingane, alluding that he had expelled one of the Zulu rivals in the region. Dingane could have easily interpreted that as a veiled threat because of how aggressive the Boers were being in the region. This initial interaction may have set the stage for Dingane's mindset from jump. Anyway, Piet Retief seemed confident, despite warnings, that he was going to convince the Zulu to recede some lands so that the Boers can settle. Now, concerning Dingane's agreement to this, which of course doesn't sound like typical Zulu custom to give something up without a fight, some scholars suggest that Dingane was certainly not going to honor the agreement because, from the Zulu perspective, that land was divinely inherited, and no agreement with a foreigner was going to change that. Again, the Zulu are well aware of the fact that warfare is deception. Dingane was receiving reports from his intelligence that the white settlers were doing a sort of reconnaissance mission to see how powerful the Zulu were. These factors may have influenced his distrust of the Boers. Anyway, Dingane apparently agreed to a land grant on condition that the Boers retrieve some cattle that was stolen by a local rebel leader. One scholar suggests that this was a strategic move by Dingane to see if the white settlers could be trusted. The settlers did indeed return with the cattle, but according to Dingane's intelligence officers, they did not give back all the cattle. Other sources, probably oral, suggest Dingane was also promised horses and guns along with the cattle and did not receive it. This context is important to make sense of Dingane's obvious distrust. Dingane viewed the Boers not as settlers, but as conquerors. and via hindsight, it's really not hard to imagine why. Anyway, it seems as though Dengane wanted to take preemptive action and use deception to gain his advantage. A celebration ensued, commemorating the agreement. Dengane invited the Boers to witness a dance by his soldiers. Then, while they were comfortable, he ordered his men to capture all the Boers, 100 in number, and take them to a nearby hillside, where they were all slaughtered. This was a pretty memorable moment in South African history, because in many ways, it exemplified the battle of historical perspectives between Africans and Europeans, and both their claims of innocence in all interaction. Ultimately, after this event, the Zulu were undone by Boer ambition, which was the fear of Dengane, and the overall narrative vilified the Zulu, leaving their perspective to be eaten by vultures, just as the Zulu did to the Boers on that hillside. Anyway, it's always refreshing to hear an often neglected perspective on African history, especially when it's buried away under old social and political paradigms or systems. Well, I'm all out, guys. If you like these videos and want to help in its continued production, consider supporting the home team on patreon.com. The link is in the description box below. Know thyself. Remember your ancestors. Peace.